No, I'm really serious. I think that's a good idea.
Just talking? Well, what's the show about?
It's about nothing.
No story?
No, forget the story.
You gotta have a story.
Who says you gotta have a story?
Some men aren't looking for anything logical, like mummy. Some men just want to watch the ride bout.
They're only trying to realize the truth.
Wait.
There is no spoon.
There is no spoon. Spoon's in mouth.
I'll tell you what it's worth. Not a damn thing. It's a waste of time.
Frivolous Fandom with Mike and Kev. I'm Mike.
I am Kev.
And we're going to get into some nerd stuff. This week, we're going to discuss a series that, I don't know about you, Kev, I've got mixed emotions about. I have a love and despise relationship with this iteration of a previously
mixed,
much beloved.
Mixed is putting it mildly, yeah. Mixed is a euphemism in this case. This week, we're talking about The Legend of Korra. Now, obviously, this show has come up in our conversation just kind of naturally a couple times. Mm-hmm. We talked about it a bit back when we had Steven on a while back when the world building cast. And we decided that we thought we would give it its own time to shine here, give it its own cast, because season 3 just wrapped up, actually. Like a month ago, maybe?
Yeah, just about. And thanks
just
to
about.
Thanks to an accelerated timetable.
Yeah, the season 4 is premiering on October 3rd, which by the time you guys are hearing this, means it will, like, basically be out.
Yeah.
And that kind of took me by surprise. I found this out, like, 2 days ago, and I was like, what? What? And we had talked about doing a cast for Legend of Korra, and then we're like, well, I guess we just should now, because the time is now, because
yeah. It's
apparently the final season, which, not really that disappointing in my opinion. I'm not that torn up to hear this news.
Nah.
But figure now is the time, so we can talk about season 3 and kind of what we thought about it, and, like, certain things that it did well, and then we'll just say what we think about going into season 4. Mike, let's talk about how bad book 2 was real fast. Book 1 had a lot of issues.
I'm the pit bull in this situation. The problem with book 2 is that we didn't have any character expansion for Korra.
Mm-mm.
I didn't feel like she learned anything.
No.
Or changed or matured or anything.
No.
Remotely resembling progression. On top of that, the decisions made didn't make sense.
Mm-mm.
The way the villain kind of rose to prominence didn't have an organic feel to it.
Did they explain, like, because with Aman they kind of had like a backstory to where you find out like his dad, and by the way, let's just say this, full spoilers for all of the everything that's happened in Korra, so like if you haven't watched all the way through the finale of book 3, like, just don't even bother, go finish it real fast and come on back. But anyways, didn't you find out, like, Amon's dad, I'm trying to remember now, it's been a while since I watched the season 1 finale, but, like, his dad always pushed them to be the best.
Yeah, his dad was a former mobster, you know, Aang took his power, so he's like, you know, that's fine, I'm gonna make my two kids be the craziest benders ever, and we're gonna get them back.
Right.
And, you know, abusive parents, you know, always pump out really just well-rounded and adjusted children.
Right, and then you find out that Noatak was, which was his original name, he was, like, the best, or he was, like, a prodigy, basically. So then the dad pushed him so hard and blah, 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 and was kind of cruel to him. Okay, whatever, I get it. It makes sense.
Yeah.
But, like, Umlak, I don't think they ever gave him a real reason that he was evil than he should be.
I mean, he was Scar.
Yeah.
That's basically what it was. And like annoyed that he couldn't be chief of the tribe. And that's, I mean, literally, it's like a really bad attempt at Hamlet, except one of them does evil juju magic and the other one's just a decent decent waterbender.
Right.
So that's how that worked out. The problem with season 2 for me, or book 2, is that there just didn't seem to be any consequences for actions. Like,
no.
The political intrigue was the high point of it, but all the side quests that were happening, really fruitless in the end. Now, maybe they'll wrap it up a little bit, because it does look like a few characters popped up in the trailer.
Right.
some ones that had a lot to do with season two and how that went down.
Right.
And I do have to give credit to the creators. They do manage to tie up loose ends better than expected. But the ending to season two almost convinced me not to watch the season
three. Deus Ex Avatar.
That honestly, like, I think the Greek who invented Deus Ex Machina would have just pulled out his hair and smashed his head against the table, going, yeah, like, that's not how you do it.
It's gotten hard because you can tell that the first show took things to a certain level, and so they felt like, in terms of the bending, like, the powers had to get crazier for this season, and so, like, just
But things... they've really not gotten crazy. I mean, the bending hasn't gotten crazier, but it's the ephemeral kind of, like, out-of-the-box stuff that they've...
You're right.
...jumped the shark over.
Yeah, right. Like...
Like, because if all it took was... You know, all I gotta do
now
to
Now
be...
there's lava bending.
And... Yeah. All I gotta do is sit under this one special tree and meditate on my inner personhood, and I turn into a giant spirit thingy.
And here's... Okay, yeah, I don't know. We might have talked this hard about world building, but can anybody at all, please write in on our Tumblr page or wherever and let us know... Why did it have to be Korra to pray under that tree? Because I remember Tenzin thinks about doing it, and then like, I forget how the conversation goes exactly, but they're like, Korra, it has to be you. And I'm like, wait, why does it have to be Korra again? She doesn't have Rava. She's literally not Avatar anymore right
She's
now.
Just a really, really annoying girl
who's not very spiritually in tune. So
who now has useless information on how to do all the other bending, which I'm just going to give her the benefit of the doubt and assume that she still has water bending, as that's her ethnicity.
Right.
But... She knows all the movements behind all the other bendings. She just can't do them anymore.
Right. But it's like she wasn't a spiritually strong person, so it's like, why did it have to be her to go pray under that tree?
And
she's the Avatar, I get it, because she has inherent spirit powers.
But you know what? Aang has fixed everything up until this point. Why not just have Aang do it?
Yeah,
like,
right.
Like, I'm not even joking. Oh, wait. He's dead.
Oh, wait, yeah. Oh, my goodness. The worst part about it is that Aang is literally gone forever now.
No, his consciousness doesn't exist.
Yeah.
Along with all of the other avatars that I've ever been, including Wan.
It's funny because that was the biggest consequence from book two, and then I forget what episode it was in season three, but it took, like, until one of the last episodes, she goes, I wish I could talk to my prior spirits about this. I'm like... Yeah, you're just understanding this.
You're telling me that there's not one but almost two civil wars where hundreds of thousands, if not maybe millions, I don't know the population counts in this show after you know the population explosion.
Right.
You know, people could die, right. And you don't feel that you should. And not only that, you get your butt handed to you by your bad guy. You're the Avatar, and you got your butt kicked by, so far as you know, a guy who can't even bend. I mean, that turned out to be BS later, but a guy who didn't bend.
Right.
Well, that'd be an interesting plot point.
No, he never bloodbent her, though, when they were fighting.
Yeah.
Wait, yeah, no, he did, actually.
Well, he bloodbent
her. To take her bending.
He bloodbent her later.
Yeah.
Which I think was funny, too, because if you think about it, it would make sense, though. This is, like, totally not true and, like, wacky conspiracy theory, but how funny would it be? We always complain about how the chi blockers and the normal people with cheap little gadgets were able to take on full benders. What if he's just sitting there, like, meditating and bloodbending all of them so that they mess up?
Right.
To give them, like, a false sense of, oh my god, these equalists are just wrecking everyone. But it's just Amon the whole time, like, bloodbending them. Okay, your attack's gonna go to the right.
I honestly buy that more. Because, like, the problem with chi blockers and then the electric power gloves, the Nintendo Power Glove.
Yeah.
The whole problem with that is they're only effective when the plot needs them to be. So, you know, towards the beginning of the season when you need to, like, really fear the equalists and, like, obviously Korra can't just shut down the whole organization right now. It's like... She can just be shot gloved instantly.
See, I
but it doesn't make any sense.
No,
if you are a firebender and they come at you with shot gloves,
wall of flame.
Make a wall of flame around yourself and push outwards until you literally burn them to a crisp.
Or better yet, they got a lot of metal on them. Zap.
Yeah.
Cough, cough. We have a firebender who can lightning bend.
This is way ahead of it. But in the finale of season three, there's the Red Lotus as the villains, and they have wacky inflatable arm.
Super wacky, not inflatable arm!
Super wacky, inflatable arm!
Struggle your opponents! What guy? Super wacky, inflatable arm!
Arm waterbender gal. And then Zuko.
We managed to string together Family Guy and
I just thought of that right now. But anyways... Zuko shocks her, and I'm like...
No, not Zuko.
Or, yeah, my bad. Mako. Sorry, I sometimes close, I wish close. I wish we had, we had Zuko Aqua, back. Zuko, yeah. Mako, yeah, never mind. I'm sorry. Zuko doesn't deserve to be compared to Mako.
Young Zuko doesn't.
But he finally shocks her, and then she's just done. She's dead or whatever, and you're like, why did it take this long of fighting her to figure out maybe I should just electrocute her?
Think about it, homie. Think about it.
Because then the show would be over on, like, episode two. But, like, that, yeah, that's my, it's the same thing with why I...
Or Deus Ex Bolin Lava Bender.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they finally had to make him have worth in some ways. He's so worthless.
All of the worth!
But, like, that's the same reason I always argue with people who like Nightwing, or not Nightwing, I like Nightwing.
Careful, our friend John will come after.
Yeah, no, I like Nightwing, actually. No, I argue with people that like Hawkeye, or what's the DC equivalent?
A Green Arrow.
Green Arrow. It's like the bone arrow power.
They're a living plot device.
They're a living plot device. Their arrows are only going to work when the plot needs them to. 99% of the time, though, the villain will just bat away the arrows or like, or I'm impervious, and they bounce off or whatever happens. And then all of a sudden, nobody can beat this guy, and then he hits them with like this new rubberized arrow that like encapsulates them in some special formula.
Or how Hawkeye's the only person able to shoot tranquilizer arrows at the Hulk. I'm like, okay, you're telling me that Captain America couldn't be given like a
trank gun or something?
A trank grenade.
Yeah.
Like, or better yet, any of the superheroes or villains who are in a punching match with the Hulk, and that happens. Like, people are in the middle of a slugfest. Like, have a gas mask on, grab him, and go, throw the grenade! It's not that hard! And then suddenly, Bruce Banner's asleep.
Was it you that was talking about, like, what if the Hulk just, like, eats a horse, let's just say, or something crazy like that? Yeah. And then they manage to calm him down, and he shrinks back to Bruce Banner size? Like, would he explode?
Stomach just explodes.
Yeah, because he has a horse inside him?
Well, I mean, okay, spoilers if anybody wants to read the Old Man Logan series, which, I mean...
Oh, yeah. No, let's just... That one, I'm not a fan.
Let's just say, don't eat Wolverine.
Yeah, right.
If you're Bruce Banner.
Right. Oh man, I got a stomachache.
Not even you, Hulk. Not even you. Anyways.
So back to Korra. Back to season 3. Mike, overall, do you think it was an improvement over the past two seasons?
That's like saying, you know, my leg's not broken anymore. Am I faster? yes, I am.
Yeah, right. It's like I'm the tallest midget is basically what that's like. Yeah, I agree. Season 3 was an improvement. It really had low standards to go against.
And not to say that it was. I mean, season 3 was thoroughly enjoyable. I did.
Yeah,
I
don't
like
think
it.
It was like crazy good or anything, but I found myself just like rolling my eyes less, at least.
Oh yeah, they. I mean, there were whole arcs where I literally like put it on in the background and did homework. And right. Then if something semi-important popped up, I'd stop and look.
Right.
But, like, a.k.a. anything involving Lin Beifong's little, chi-point-induced PTSD incident.
Yeah.
Like, I'm gonna... Here's the deal. I love my sister. We have a good relationship. Even if she was a terrible human being, I don't think I would just randomly try to kill her.
Right.
I mean, there would have to be her trying to kill me, her trying to kill my future spouse, her trying to do something, like killing my dog, something.
Right.
But no, like Lynn just, and Lynn, a very cold and rational and type A to the max personality person, gets up from this acupuncture session and just starts, and I'm like, okay, whatever she had
just
went through.
Wakes up and goes off like the Hulk just ate a horse or something.
I look at the acupuncturist and go, you know what, my appointment with you? You know, let's just cancel that. Like, no, that didn't seem to work for her.
You're right. Like, okay, here's the problem with all of the character interactions in this show. It always involves one hard-headed person won't let the other hard-headed person do something, right? And then the one person goes off the edge and does something stupid, and then they have to go save them. The person who said no is like, oh, this is all my fault because I pushed them into this, goes and saves the day, and then they're like, okay, now we're gonna hug, and then you're right, I was wrong. Everything, let's just do it 100% your way.
And we don't learn anything ever.
And nobody learns anything. Cause like, so for instance, Korra goes and like breaks out of Tenzin's house in season 1 and like goes and pro-bends, and then all of a sudden Tenzin's like, you know what, you're right, I was too strict. You can pro-bend now! No punishment for breaking all of my rules.
Which I will argue actually hurt her skills in actual combat. Like, I love how they try to pitch, like, I need to learn modern styles of bending.
Right.
And then me, And Kevin can back me up, because we watched this episode together at our friend's house. I turn to them and look. I go, from a martial arts perspective, that is stupid.
Hey, right.
If I'm about to go to war, I'm not going to learn tournament-style fighting.
Right.
No. Uh-uh. I'm going to learn how to kill you as fast as possible.
Yeah, right. You throw that little earth disc at me, and I'm going to, like, throw a wall of boulders at you.
Yeah. Well, or better yet, they tell the water bears, you can't take the water from around the stage and use it. You know what Katara would tell you? Like, oh, yeah, right. That's cute.
Yeah, right.
Just water everywhere.
Right. Yeah, it's just, there's a lot of examples. I'm going to blank on them now that I've made this big, bold proclamation. But, for instance, I mean, another one is when Lin fought with the sister. Like, they're just, like, fighting, about to kill each other. And then Lin's like, you're right. I was,
sorry, PTSD's over.
Yeah, PTSD's done. Let's hug. Okay, you're right. It's just like every time, it's always so one-sided. I mean, generally it's with Tenzin.
And honestly, Korra, they had a compelling narrative they could have told.
Yeah.
Could have told. Didn't. Right.
I love how, the sister lies and lets Korra go, and then is like, oh, oops. And then, like, Lin was totally cool with it now because they had, like, it's so one-dimensional. They fought, they made up, and now everything's hunky-dory between them. Even to the fact that the sister lies to her the next day.
Yeah, yeah.
Lin would be like, okay, nope, I'm pissed again. Like, why would you be chill with that?
I mean, Lin Beifong, who was a grade-A biatch to Korra when she first met her.
You're right.
Just because
Lin has another one.
She's got a metal rod so far up her keister that it's tickling her brain.
Wasn't Lin another one where, like, Korra's like, you have to let me go my path.
And yeah, oh,
like,
yeah.
Okay, you're right.
Fine. Like, yeah.
And I think that's why Korra is always so slow to learn anything.
Everyone just caves.
Everyone just caves to her every time. I mean, sure, she has to, like, be upset and throw a hissy fit for, like, a half an episode.
I mean, and you know what? I'm not a proponent of this in real life, but in this show, I want someone to beat some smart into her.
Yeah, right.
Just take a big stick, write the word smart on it, and just whack her until she gets it. Like, you are not smart. You are not making good decisions. Everything you want to do, do the opposite, and the world will be a healthy place.
You're right. Pull a George Costanza. If every impulse you have is wrong, then logically, the opposite will always be right. I think the problem is with the finale of Avatar, The Last Airbender, where Aang, like, they kind of have the threat of Aang losing the Avatar state. Or dying in the Avatar state. It's like, now, every time, like, they feel like they have to up the ante, and so if Korra isn't about to ruin the Avatar state forevermore, it's, like, not compelling. It's like, you could have pretty high stakes without going there.
Yeah.
And then, I just think it's silly because, from last season, where she lost the Avatar state and then got it back because Jinora put it back in or whatever, I don't know, they never really explained it.
See, I would have very much liked to have some kind of a, you know, if we're gonna jump the shark, let's ride that ramp to its conclusion. You know what? Let's say she doesn't get all the Avatar state back. What if, like, Rob is broken up into pieces and it's multiple people? Better yet, let's go full corny Avengers Assemble. Each of the Avatar, Team Avatar now gets a chunk. And you know what? It's a little bit of Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, but at least it's progression. It's movement towards a difference. And then maybe that discussion is, you know what? You can't have one person shoulder this burden. So you know what? Everybody does. Right. We have people from every race now. One person, each group. The real balance. You know, so even if one of them's bad and they're fighting each other, there's still balance. That makes sense.
Right.
And then, you know what? There's probably dozens of other things they could have done with it. But her getting the power back because Deus Ex Jinora, you know, Floaty Aang's granddaughter who magically can just find every spirit in the world.
Right.
Or in the spirit world, which apparently was difficult.
Right.
But I don't know. There were actually a lot of good stuff about it.
One last gripe. So, for instance, you know, talking about how there's never any consequences for a lot of the stuff. So it's like you're saying, it would have been cool if now that Rava got broken up, something as a result of that happens, and now there's, like, a new challenge phase, not just, oh, she's Avatar Korra again, whee! She doesn't have, obviously, the prior lifetimes experience to draw upon, but, I mean, it's not like she ever did that anyways, so it's not that big of a deal.
And I'm waiting for Tenzin to sit down with her and go, okay, do you want to talk about this? Like, we need to work out the emotional trauma you should have.
Yeah, and that you've just wasted 1,000 lifetimes worth of experience.
Yeah, I mean, where's the guilt? Where is the Right. Where is the self-doubt right. that should, in a sane human being,
right.
be there? I mean, she goes, oh, I shouldn't have done the spirit portal. I'm like, okay, that should be the beginning thought.
Right.
But there should be others. Like, okay, what could I have done differently?
Right.
Where's that? I mean, how often did Aang agonize?
How often did Aang save the day and then, like, have to sit down and, like, have a heart-to-heart because he felt so guilty about this one little thing he could have done better?
Yeah. Or better yet, you know, essentially, I'm going to take a stab. The number of people Aang lost when the Air Nation was destroyed is roughly the same number of lifetimes vanished. When Korra became apparently now the only consciousness of the Avatar in existence. Right. And
at least the next Avatar in the cycle can look back and be like,
here's what I don't do.
I will do the exact opposite. I'm going to George Costanza her.
Yeah.
But so
I mean,
then,
knowing our luck, I mean, who's next in the cycle? It's earthbending, right?
Yes. Yeah, earthbenders. So
the nation that's in chaos, turmoil, and revolution, probably going through a reign of
this
terror.
Way, at least you're not going to have that bogus Earth Queen trying to utilize the Avatar for her needs.
I quote the French Revolution when I say this. Was King Louis a jerk? Yes. Was Marie Antoinette stupid? Yes. Although she did not say anything about cake. That was a myth.
Really?
Was it better than Maximilian Robespierre and the Department of Public Safety, you can't see me do air quotes with my hands, beheaded everybody, including him. No, it was not better. It was not worse. It was better. So I still think that crappy, corrupt Earth Kingdom, compared to what's going on right now with the burning and the pillaging and probably the other bad stuff I should be talking about on audio, yes, I think it was better. And that poor Avatar, if Korra dies, is going to be born in that time period.
You're right. Right. But like one more example of no consequences. So she leaves the spirit portals open, right? And then season 3, this is one of my complaints of season 3.
They're a real spirit.
They try to,
they try to sneeze and it doesn't go well.
I'm airbending. that was my airbending. So the show tries to spin it in this positive fashion, right? Look at all these new earthbenders they have. We're gonna fulfill Aang's legacy and his hope of rebuilding the Air Nation by taking all these Air Acolytes and, like, acclimating them into Air Nation culture. So, okay, cool, that's real positive. But then you realize that Republic City is getting completely and utterly destroyed by the spirit.
By the spirit vines. Spirit apparently, vines? Apparently no landscaper and has the ability
Korra
to cut
them. Korra has no idea how to fix them. Like, she tries, and then they just come back. And so then she just, like, I mean, I guess she was asked to leave, so it's not totally her fault. She just leaves.
Well,
never hear about Republic City again. I'll quit griping now for a little bit. Let's actually talk about some things that we liked with season 3. Some things that improved as easy as it was to do upon the season 2 miscarriages.
Lethal bending.
Yeah, definitely. They upped the ante, and one of the cool ways they upped the ante was with the Red Lotus, the leader of the Red Lotus, Zaire was his name.
An oddly Arabic name for a group of.
You know what's funny? Did they ever acknowledge that the Red Lotus could never have risen to power like they did without Korra leaving the spirit portals open? Did they ever mention that?
No, of course not, because that would somehow say that Avatar Korra is not the best Avatar ever.
Right. And then it would suggest that maybe it wasn't the right. Oh my gosh. I'm sorry. Yeah, so Zaire gets airbending because of he's just one of the chosen randomly by the nature or whatever you want
to
call it.
Happens to be the guy who's obsessively learned about their
and,
their
yeah, he happens
culture.
To have been obsessing over airbending culture and learned all their ways for the years and whatnot.
It's like being able to do Tai Chi your entire life, not ever expecting to be able to, like, shoot Kai Blasts and then magically one day, oh, I can shoot Kai Blasts. It's a good thing I've been doing Tai
Chi
this whole time.
Good thing I've been reading manga for a long time. So he happens to get it. So now, for the first time, we see an airbending master without the, what's the word I'm looking for? Restraint and, like, mental training of the airbenders.
Without the skill.
No, what am I looking for? That's not the right word. Without the morality, I guess.
Yeah.
Because a big thing with the airbenders is, like, spiritual,
right.
And it's the everything. So he only has half the equation. He knows what it is, but he doesn't necessarily agree with their ideals. Is a completely different ideal set. So he takes the airbending into a lethal place, which is something we've never seen before.
And he's as deeply spiritual as them. He's just, instead of being a I mean, because the airbending culture seems to be very Buddhist, very peaceful, very, you know, don't rock the boat, just be nice and be nice to everybody else and life goes on. He's a nihilist. He's a dark, dark, dark type of nihilist who honestly gets a little cartoony in terms of the villain stuff towards the end. But building up to the point, he was intriguing.
Right.
He was really fun to watch because he's saying, you know what? My logic is said. We don't need an avatar. We don't need kings. We don't need fire lords. We don't need presidents. We need to go back to the way nature was beforehand because there was a time before the avatar.
Right.
And that's nuts. I mean, that's crazy. But he's like, you know, and here's very clearly a smart person who studied all of the greats. He's you know, he can quote an airbender philosopher who lived thousands of years ago.
Right.
And, you know, he's like, you know what? We need to go back. And he has the hindsight that no one else seems to do and the foresight that no one seems to share. And so it makes him a dangerous enemy.
Right.
Because he's not motivated by real greed, or at least it didn't look like it until the very end. He's motivated by something a lot more dangerous. He's an idealist.
Right. He's a misguided zealot, would you say, Mike?
Yes, I would.
So that was cool. Definitely seeing him take it to a new spot. And then they had the lava bending, so they had a couple new little twists to throw in with the bending, even though lava bending's
I
want
to know what's up with the Sparky Boom tattoo. I think
Sparky Boom.
Is it a family trait? Is this?
Yeah, they never explained
did
why.
Did you just drag this poor kid out from under his bed when he's like six, and then give him the tattoo, and then if he's a firebender, he gets to do it, but it hurts or something?
Right.
Also, she can't stop when she starts.
Apparently not. Yeah.
I mean, that was a pretty cool
one. It's like pulling the pin on the grenade. You can cook it, but it's not like you can, like, put out the extinguish it.
I love how she didn't even try to, like, rip it, like, use her hands to rip it off. She just was like, oh, no.
I think she understood. They slow-moed it, Mike. I think they were trying to imply it happened in a fraction of a second.
She just exploded.
She exploded.
I would have been funny had they shown, like,
she sparked. She sparked. She boom-boomed.
Yeah.
So that was another cool thing in a new twist on it. So he sees Zaheer was in love with Sparky, Sparky Boom Boom, and then she goes boom, and so he literally he already had very few cares in the world in terms of physical possessions or anything worldly. She was like the last thing keeping him attached to this earth. So it kind of reminded me of Avatar Aang when he couldn't let go of Korra, so he couldn't unlock his last chakra. That kind of like unlocked his last chakra. And he quotes one of the major philosophers who says, sever your earthly tether. And so he does, and then Zaheer literally gets the power of flight. He doesn't need to have a sail and then then airbend. He can just float and flies around. Mike, what did you think of that?
Which, to me, if I'm Jinora or I'm Tenzin, I need to get on that.
Yeah, right.
I need to figure out whatever that madman did. It is a shame to all new airbenders that the evil guy can fly and we cannot.
Right.
Get on that, Tenzin.
I just fail to believe. Well, I guess Aang had some earthly attachments. I was just going to say, I fail.
Aang chose to.
Yeah.
I mean, because I think the true nature of Aang's paradox is that Aang refused to make the full sacrifice to be.
Well, you know, I don't think the full commitment to airbending is necessarily a good thing, because if you sever all earthly commitment, you're foregoing a lot of good you could do for your own peace. I mean, sure, you're at peace or whatever, you've reached nirvana, but
I don't think it's nirvana. I think you have one of two options. You can reach the very Buddhist concept of nirvana, where you are an enlightened, compassionate being. Zaheer was degaffing. It's not that he severed all earthly attachment and was very concerned with the well-being of all spirits. And, you know, no, he just didn't care anymore.
Yeah.
So I think that supreme confidence of spirit, the supreme faith is what gave him that power.
Right.
So I think, I wouldn't even be surprised if Jinora figures out how to do it. Tenzin, I mean, if they want to pull another, you know, Tenzin does more personal growth than the main character.
Yeah, Tenzin finally kind of held his own for once, even though I still think he makes the wrong decision 100% of the time.
I mean, it was funny to watch Zaheer, like, kind of get knocked around. Like, Zaheer openly says, he's like, it's an honor to meet an actual master. And as they're fighting, Zaheer's putting up a good fight because he's a little more ferocious.
Well, but I think they tried to indicate that Tenzin was kind of pulling the lead in a way.
The whole time. But Tenzin didn't have the killer instinct.
Right, right.
And that's the difference. I mean,
I think Zaheer would have won in the end because he's willing to kill. And is the power of belief, and where it turns in is usually a little doubting Thomas, as we found out, because mm-hmm. he wasn't the master that he thought he was, so that's why they needed Jinora, who's apparently already surpassed him at age 12, but whatever.
I feel like she is going to be a little dynamo in the next 3 years.
Right.
I'm sure there's some kind of, like, airbender culture thing that we don't know.
We'll see how it goes. Obviously, if you think about it, so let's jump ahead to just quickly about season four. One thing we do know, and we'll talk a little bit more about it, is that season four is going to see a 3-year jump.
Mm-hmm.
So season four is going to take place in the future. You know, far enough in the future that there's going to be a lot of changes.
And we're going back to the future.
One person, though, in particular who will actually see a lot of changes is Milo. You have to think so, because he's at that age where 3 years is actually a long time.
Oh, yeah.
10's and 3 years older. Yeah, okay, whatever. You might not notice.
I'm going to laugh if Milo is, like, boomy, and he's just the I mean, he's boomy with airbending.
Right.
How ADD is that?
But I just want somebody from that family to be important besides Jinora, because you think about it, Inky and I just said his name. Milo. They don't really do anything. They're just kind of funny, I guess.
I think they'll get to the point where they are actually capable of bending and actually participating.
Because, let's be honest, let's talk about one of the new characters, Mike, Kai.
Oh, God.
What do you think about Kai? Keep it short, because I'm sure people have read enough online.
Yeah, they took Aladdin, and they said, let's make him an airbender, and make him 12, and make him the teenage love interest.
Not the love interest we deserved. Not the love interest we needed. Not the love interest we wanted.
I love how Mako...
Take that.
Like, Mako's just looking at him like, you little sh... I know exactly what you are.
Right.
Like, no, you don't. I'm, like, it does a puppy eyes. Everyone's like, aw.
Everyone looks at Mako. Mako, you're in no position to talk.
Yeah.
Did you like her daughter that is going love interest for Bolin?
I always thought it was kind
of... That's now an airbender, too, apparently. So she is... I forget. Could she not metal
bend? No, she was the black sheep of the family, and now she's special.
Now she's an airbender.
That could have been a cool little, like... I mean, it
would
have been...
Seems awful convenient, but whatever.
Yeah. It would have been a nice little kind of bonding point, because Mako is always kind of the... Oh, no, not Mako. Bolin's kind of the... He's the... What's the term? It's not a woobie. What is it on TV Tropes? He's the dog to kick. He's the...
Yeah, right. He's just the comedic relief.
I mean, he's, you know, he's the...
Why?
Butt monkey. He's the butt monkey.
But here's the problem. Why is he not with Asami? One of my biggest problems with the show now is Asami, because she is so chill, so cool towards everybody, even though she's got kind of, like, crapped on in that whole situation.
Oh, she's got a reason to, like, despise two out of the four.
Yeah, and they don't really... I mean, I guess they apologize. Mako apologizes and stuff, but, like, they... I don't know. Like, I feel like they have not adequately explained why she just... I mean, I guess she could just be one of those people that is so cool and so chill and so laid back that they forget...
Or she's just a sociopath who's like, this is about the most excitement I'm going to get in my life.
Right.
So
that's
I'm
the only thing
along.
I can think is, like, why is she not, like, doing something and running
the company?
Well,
for the record, not all sociopaths are bad people. Exactly.
She inherited a company and she's never doing anything
she's
to
She's probably
run
really
it.
Bored. Like, she's like, I'm a billionaire at age, what, 19?
Right.
Like, okay, like...
Right.
I'm just going to hang out with these people. This is fun.
Because, like, the thing is, Bolin could have been, hey, I know you got burned by Mako. Pun intended. He's a firebender.
It was shocking, really.
In case you didn't get that.
Got it.
You should have waited about two or three episodes longer than you should have to make that joke. But Bolin could have been like, yeah, he screwed you over. Remember, I liked Korra, and then she screwed me over. We're kind of alike that. And then remember, I'm super loyal. I would never leave you if you were my girlfriend. Bada bing, bada boom. Cause that's what, and then.
Plus, I got a fire fan.
Wasn't there one part two, I think in season two, where they like ran up and then Mako picks up Korra and then Bolin picked up Asami, I thought, or something. So like, I thought they were gonna go that route.
And friend zone.
And then they just didn't go, I don't know. I don't really care about the romance overall, cause. And I think we can agree that one of the improvements for season three is there's far less romance other than Jinora and Kai.
Which I mean, I almost feel like it's just wasted screen time.
Yeah,
at
it
some
is.
Point.
It is.
Like, you could have cut Kai out of the story and it would not have mattered.
No,
you could have just had one of the stupid Dai Li people kidnap one of the airbending kids on accident.
Right.
That would have been really easy. Like, one of the airbending kids runs off and dresses up. Like, God, you're telling me, Milo? doesn't run off and just take some earthbending clothes and get in trouble
right.
with a bunch of other earthbending kids.
Oh, no, I agree. Everything Kai has done, Milo. It could have been Milo doing it.
Yeah.
And that way I'm not sitting here complaining about, like, what do Inky and Milo even do for the show? There's too many characters. Like, Asami, like, they give her the reason, like, when they crash in the desert and she helps fix their ship. So, okay, cool, I guess. She's the techie one. So now basically she's the Batman of the group.
But how cool would it have been to actually have her loser? Like, go, you know, fine. If I'm not even involved in this stuff, I'm taking my ship and going home.
Yeah, right.
And have them go, oh.
Yeah,
man. Wow, we are really being jerky about this. Like, we've been pooping on you this entire time.
Yeah, right. There's so many characters that just, and Bolin, that are underdeveloped, or not underdeveloped, but underutilized. And then Mako, it's funny because they made him Detective Mako, and he had his value that way. But for the most part, I really could tell they diminished his role in the show.
Yeah, now he's just the pretty boy who's there to be awkward.
Yeah, he's just positive and determined. He's not awkward, he's just determined. That's his value now.
Yeah. Well, he's no, like, I mean,
we can do this, guys.
There's that awkward, like, they have to throw in the awkwardness between him and Korra still.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay. Yeah. Like, clearly That's she true. Doesn't give a hoot.
Apparently she finally embraced being Avatar after she ruined being Avatar. So, Mike, what did you think of Red Lotus overall?
You know, honestly, I liked what they were going for initially.
Definitely fell off the end.
Yeah, I would have liked more of a, holy crap, there's more of these people than we thought.
Right. And That's granted, true, there's only four, like, there's four of them plus the one guy.
There's, like, a couple of guards who have been, what, hanging out in this cave this entire time? I'm like, now, how crazy would it have been had Republic City, not surprisingly, sent forces to protect the Avatar, who's their only hope of getting the weeds out of their garden?
Would it have been too cheesy if it had turned out that the Red Lotus, like, funded Amon's early efforts or something? Because they were...
I would be okay with that. Like, I would be okay with it
being, why not, like, natural order? Natural, like, no magic for some people and not for not.
Or better yet, or, you know what? We'll have them take out the government, and then we'll just kill him on. Better yet, we'll show that he's a bender, and they'll rip him apart for all four of us.
Right. That'd have been cool.
He can't bloodbend all of them.
Right.
And that's literally not only that. They have projectile weapons. Doesn't matter if he bloodbends all of them. Some crazy person with a giant crossbow laser beam thing is going to take him out. I mean, that'd be cool.
Right.
And better yet, like, have people in the government who don't know. No one knows. Like, have an actual Illuminati kind of thing where it's like, holy crap, a lot of people in power are part of this Red Lotus thing.
Right.
Or just a lot of people.
Right.
Like, they go into an inn trying to get a room, and he's like, oh, don't worry, you know, it's like, oh, we need to, you can't tell anybody we're here. Like, it's really important, the Avatar has to be safe. He's like, oh, don't worry, like, go into the room in the back, I won't say anything, like, just, you know, stay out of sight. And then have him walk in and whisper something and have the kid run away and you see somebody and they, like, there's like a handshake or something that the Red Lotus know. Like, how cool would that, like, it would build paranoia, it'd build tension, it would build a lot of cool stuff. And they just didn't, I don't know, they whiffed.
Yeah.
Like, here's the thing, the creators' names are escaping me and I should know them by now, but they have done fantastic work in story crafting and world crafting.
Right.
And so we're definitely sounding really critical. But that's because we know what these guys are capable of.
It's because, like, Avatar Last Airbender was so tight, like, so tight-knit, and everything had its place and was fully fleshed out, and I think the problem is that if it came down to it, I don't think they had any true desire to do Legend of Korra other than, like, they had the opportunity and could make some money. I really don't think this is, because if you think about it, this story they made, I don't think they had this in mind.
Or I think that half of the stuff
they wanted... I think Nickelodeon approached them, and they said, okay, I guess we'll write the next Avatar. She's a waterbender, right? Okay, yeah, and then there's they went from it like that, but they didn't really have their heart and soul in it like they did for the last one.
Well, and I have a point about that, but that fits into what we're going to talk about later. So let's cruise through the lady who I was very happy died.
Then the other new character they introduced was the Earth Queen.
And who eats a bear?
Yeah, we already alluded that she died, and she ate the bear from Last Airbender.
That bear's been around
since forever.
There are plenty of foul, misogynist words I could use for this woman, and none of them would be enough. You don't eat a bear.
Yeah, right.
Especially a bear that can do handstands.
Especially just to say F you to your dead father, who, like, can't even sense the F you, I don't think.
I don't know how afterlives work in this story, but I'm pretty sure he doesn't care.
Yeah, right. It's like, you just... And he was an old bear. He was in his twilight years, probably just chilling, finally...
He slept 13 hours a day.
Finally hit retirement, you know. He didn't have to do handstands anymore for 12 hours a day.
Probably had a couple female bears laying around. It was awesome. And then you ate her.
I don't know. The character was horrible. She died. Is there anything else needs to be said? She wasn't interesting.
Strong character.
Yeah.
I would have liked to have elaborated more on her, why she's resentful.
Yeah, right. Why is she so skeptical and such a power hungry B word, for lack of
a word. Well, but yeah, let's have a flashback or something where she explains to Korra, no, I have a reason to not like the Avatar or anything to do with the Republic City. My father was so busy trying to please you, and then show a flashback of, you know what? Team Avatar was not nice to somebody, or they were dismissive of somebody, or in trying to get...
Well, maybe, like, Avatar A never really took her father seriously or something.
And yeah, and really not even that they're being bad, it's just that, you know what, they've got a job to do, they've got a goal in mind. People get... Politics, people make got lifelong, almost to the dead enemies, just by having conflicting goals.
Right.
That's politics, that's life, in terms of anything involving policy and power. Friendships crumble as soon as you guys are voting for different things, because they affect people. And so, you know what? Yeah, he's like, well, but I thought I'd get the Earth stuff back. And Aang's like, you know what? I understand that, but what you're not understanding is that these Fire Nation people are here and they're going to fight. We're going to have another war on our hands. Sorry, it can't work. And then just kind of blow them off. And, of course, the Earth King's like, well, I guess if the Avatar...
The Earth King's kind of a happy-go-lucky guy, so he's like, yeah. But then, you know, his daughter's like...
And what if his daughter was an idealist at first and was getting really pissed off? Like, no, they took our land. They killed our people. Why is this son of a genocidal maniac calling any shots? And to be fair, she's got a point. This hypothetical point of hers is the hypothetical version.
She is a very acute and aware young gal. This
yes, queen, this, this hypothetical queen. But instead, we just get a spoiled, rotten, psychopathic animal fetish eating.
Ooh, I don't know what her goal was. Why did she want the Airbenders?
She wanted an army. Which I guess what cracks me up at this point.
Why
is...
Why would an army of Airbenders? What?
I honestly, an army of Airbenders and Earthbenders, I think, would tip the balance. But I don't think an army of Airbenders and Earthbenders can overcome the combined might of Republic City, the new
but
technology.
Who's going to train the Airbenders in the way of airbending? Her Dailies?
Yeah. Yeah.
Was she going to capture? I don't know. Whatever. She's dead now, by the way. Spoilers. Which, that was...
Ding
that,
dong,
it was a great
dead,
scene.
The
it was cool.
Dead,
it was cool.
Dead.
So let's talk about one of the base improvements, and that is at the end of the season, Korra had the poison in her mm-hmm. system. You were talking about this a little bit, and then... Last we see of her, she's in a wheelchair and she's kind of depressed. And as far as we know, well, now we know a little bit more that they're doing a time skip, and in the preview for season 4, she's walking. So clearly she's going to get over it. But at least going into next season, there's going to be some carryover, some consequences, some struggles that she's going to have to overcome and learn from. So she's going to have to learn how to, well, I was hoping learn how to do stuff without her legs. I think it would be cool to have a paralyzed Avatar and just see how that works.
Or better yet, have her to the point where she, A, has to study with Katara how to heal. She has to learn for once. Oh, God.
Yeah, right.
And then, you know, what if she has to bloodbend to move around? How cool would that be?
She's literally manipulating her legs with bending.
Or better yet, you know what? You could do that very easily with water bending by itself. You don't have to bloodbend. You know, you're...
She could cut off her legs and become wacky inflatable leg.
Wacky leg runner. <girl. laughs>
She could walk around on a handstand that she could learn from the bear.
The bear spirit.
That's Eden.
Dismembered spirit floating bear.
But yeah, I was happy to see there's finally some consequences. Now we're shifting a little bit more about season 4, some more hypothetical and predictive stuff. We see her walking, but it's 3 years later, so I'm assuming they'll explain the process she had to undergo.
They better have, like, a PT montage or something.
And there was another short clip that I saw where Tenzin was going somewhere, and he says, no, you need to stay here and focus on your recovery. So I think the time skip is going to happen somewhere during the first episode mm-hmm. or something like that, or maybe even a couple episodes in.
Yeah.
So it's going to be good to finally see her. It's going to force some growth out of the character, which has been so sorely needed.
Well, it'll be
fun. The only growth I can really see in Korra is she's slightly less fiery than she was.
She's more reserved. She's probably going to be, or but she might be bitter, which I would even be okay with, because that'd fit more her complete lack of wisdom.
Right. But, I don't know. I'm sure we're offending a lot of fanboys and girls out there. And I don't know. We try to be reasonable with all of these things. We're not trying to just be bitter fans or anything like that, but I just hope for season 4 that they develop the character some, finally.
Yeah. Well, I just want them to streamline it, you know?
And another friend of mine who I've discussed the series with, he and I got in an argument about past characters that have been incorporated or not incorporated or badly incorporated. I just want some semblance of continuity.
Yeah.
You know what? You're telling me Katara is not politically involved with the Southern Water Tribe being taken over by the Northern?
Right.
She's got to be out there. Yeah, that's true. When
Unalaq, she'd have been the... I'm going to put you in your place to Unalaq. I remember you, your snot, sniveling nose, and you're pooping your pants kind of a thing.
Like literally, like she would have been like, oh, this little crap head. Like,
honestly, you know what they needed her to have? Not quite so blatant, but a little splash of old lady Tyrell.
Oh, yeah.
Not like, not quite so fake, she's a splash.
She's playing this the sweet old lady, but the whole time, like, everybody who knows her from her past is like, okay, remember.
She was a fiery young gal.
This woman is the wife of Avatar Aang. Remember that when dealing with her.
And she wore the pants in the relationship.
She did. Like, and so, I do think, ironically, that, you know, and then when Zuko came in, I didn't like how they kind of made him this... really dull, and
he was so dull.
He just was. I mean, I was like,
he kind of flew in on his dragon, got his butt whooped, and then disappeared until the last episode. And even then, he was just there to be there. He was just there to be there. That's what we should start saying. I've finally just figured out how to describe Asami, Bolin, Milo, Inki.
I would have preferred Zuko be bedridden and old and decrepit.
Right, right. That would have made sense at this point. Yeah.
And then better yet,
but he's there just to be there.
Where is Toph?
Where did General Iroh go? Two, by the way.
He's twiddling his thumbs.
Has he been in it since season one?
No, of course not. No, season two. Just in to go, sorry, Korra, the president told me I have to go wipe my butt over that way. That's literally what happened. And so...
Oh, my goodness. Okay.
Yeah, because Korra's like, come on, quickly, get on the boat, let's go. And the president goes, wait just a minute.
The second she finds out about the Dark Avatar, she doesn't... find out, talk to the president, and be like, hey, by the way,
you were wrong! And I'm saying that to you. I'm the wrongest person of all.
So, Mike, let's get it. Talk about season four real quick, and we'll wrap things up. I think we've griped enough.
Yeah.
This was actually supposed to be positive.
We're trying.
We actually talked to... I mean, we have a giant bullet point that says improvement on it.
Yeah, we do. And it is.
I enjoyed the season. I'm just not, like, head over heels for it because I think Korra is what it is.
Hey,
it's just
we're critical about what we care about.
Yeah, right. And I think anybody who loves... I think the problem is that Airbender is so good. So, yeah. Honestly, Korra could never have been as good, but it could still be better than it is. I'm sorry. Okay. So, for season four, the preview, we see a lot of stuff. We see Korra with a new haircut. We see Jinora with a new haircut, but...
I'm just talking about the haircut. My friend, you said that with a straight face, and I don't know what to make of that.
That was the two most important things I remembered.
I mean, to be fair, they did rip the whole... They had Zuko cut his top knot off with a very samurai-esque symbolism. Now, Korra's just like, I don't like my hair anymore, cut.
the hair is the biggest character development we've seen.
I'm gonna laugh if they try to make that symbolic. I'm gonna be like, how? It's not. It's just.
You're right.
Hair.
She's air tribe or air.
She's water tribe.
Water tribe. What am I trying to say? Yeah, she's water nation, not fire.
Well,
there's
mechanized metal clan armies now with stormtrooper, like literally, like World War One stormtrooper. Like, God, I forgot the Deutsch word for stormtrooper, but like actual. Like, gas mask-looking stormtrooper stuff.
Fallout-looking stuff.
Very clearly, these people are not the good guys.
So, yeah, I don't know if it's Lin's sister or one of her kids or something.
We have Lin's sister looking, like, sad that she's about to do something. That's how
you're right. And then we already know that she's not afraid to lie to her sister that she just made up with the day before. Like, you'd think in that situation, when you've just made progress like that, you would be honest, even if you were...
Oh, yeah. Well, here's what I think is going to happen. Korra's going to go off and do her little physical therapy session with Katara.
Right.
She's going to come back.
Jinora's going to come back and become Luke Skywalker for the Airbenders.
Well, and I think we see Kai and Jinora, you know, doing flight suit, which is, I mean, okay, cool, fair enough.
I hope Kai turns out to be a little dick and is like a sub villain.
That'd be
funny. I kind of do that way. Like his character has any meaning and
some interest.
Yeah, and then Jinora has to realize, like, not to trust people. I don't know, like, there could be something in there.
Something useful.
Yeah, right.
But I think
not to trust people, but don't trust everyone.
Yeah, I think Korra is going to come out of her seclusion. So she's gonna notice the world is balancing on a knife's edge, and I think the Airbenders are gonna be doing a pretty bang up job comparatively, considering that really that's not their role to keep balance, but they're doing an okay job.
Right.
That they're gonna piss off a lot of people.
I think I remember now why I was so intently focused on Jinora's new hair, because you can't see her airbending tattoos.
Yeah, that's the frustrating part. Like, really,
I think you should be bald, even if you're a chick.
Well, but just have like that one Avatar did, the ring around.
You're right.
You're still feminine, but you have, you know.
You're right.
And I'm pretty sure most Buddhist nuns have something similar to that.
Right.
They either have just a full head and they're covered up, or there is a head shaving thing. If there are any Buddhists out there who, you know, I'm wrong, just feel free to politely correct me.
So, Mike, do you think they're going to try to raise the ante again and then have some kind of crazy all-time epic finale? Because, honestly, I think the Season 3 finale was... It was better than Season 2, but it was much weaker in terms of grandeur. And it was weaker, I think, story-wise and grandeur-wise, it was less than Season 1. So
I'm tempted to say that I think it's going to be a little more like Season 1, where... I think it's going to be a run-of-the-mill vanilla, I'm just trying to take over the world with normal means, conquering kind of thing. And the Avatar in a weakened state can't, like, there's not even room to be epic, and that'll be kind of be like a really nasty, exhausted feeling for the Avatar towards the end, like, God, I have literally come through way worse than this, and I can't win right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and barely make it out of the skin of teeth, end on an exhausted note, and we're all just tired.
And then Jinora lifts Rava out of her and just puts her in herself.
That would be the perfect ending.
Because she's Luke Skywalker. And then they're like... And then what could it be? It could be Avatar, always Airbender or something. I don't know. So it's just like...
Because weren't you talking about it how... we were talking about this with the Airbenders, like, well, pre-Korra. So assuming back in the day that Tenzin's family was the only Airbenders...
You control them. You're going to get the Avatar.
You're going to get the Avatar in your family.
Like, guaranteed.
That'd be really cool. So it's like the Airbenders got so attuned they could lift Rava out and just keep putting him in Airbenders. So the Avatar is always Airbender.
Well, how crazy would it have been?
Because that'd be cool. Why not? Let's have the... Oh, yeah. I think in Season 4, I would love to see the Air Nomads get power hungry. Just because, why not?
And you know what would be really cool? If, like, the Fire Nation... Like, what if the royal family from the Fire Nation, like, they, like, one of Aang's kids and one of Zuko's kids, they got married. And so it's like, not only are you guaranteed going to have the Avatar in your family, you're going to have the Avatar in your family in a ruling party.
Right. That's stupid.
That doesn't sound like trouble.
Right.
And we already know Wackadoo runs in that family gene pool.
Right.
And
spoiler, it's laying dormant in Zuko's
it just skipped
old
one.
Loins.
It just skipped a generation, or better yet, Iroh beat it out of him.
You're like, right.
You are not nuts anymore.
Zuko, you will have a good head on your shoulders.
Because I'm giving you concussions of love.
Yeah, right. It's not beating, and if you're this calm, then it is just teaching. Mike, anything else to be said about Season 4? I'm trying to think of what else there was in
they
the preview.
They keep showing the Captain of the Guard.
Oh, for the metal.
So I'm assuming he's the antagonist.
You're right. Maybe Korra falls for him, huh? No, I'm just kidding. I hope not. Hopefully they'll just keep most of the romance out, because I think...
They've already mucked it up.
People had enough of it by Season 2, and so you could definitely tell that they cut back on it for Season 3. So maybe Kai and Jinora is going to be the main thing for that one. But that's why I'm kind of hoping that Kai has a little douchey streak and that they don't end up together.
Kevin's just spiteful.
Maybe 3 years of development could turn him into some semblance of anything I want to watch.
He's still just going to be a bad ripoff of Aladdin, in my opinion.
Right.
But,
I can show you the world.
As I pick your friend's pocket. Why am I doing this? I don't need money or any of the stuff inside. I've got the Avatar.
That was actually pretty good.
I'll never have to eat again.
I was just thinking that, like... So, anyways, you know, book 4, gonna take it for what it is. Good entertainment, not like the end-all be-all, such as the original series was. Sad face.
Although there's always room to surprise us.
Yeah, but, you know, I'll be surprised. I thought the worst of season three, and it honestly was better than I was bracing myself for, which is nice.
Yeah.
So hopefully season four can end it strong. I think it would be good if they could go out on a high note and have some compelling storylines and characters going in the end. So, Mike, any last thoughts?
You know what? I just hope that they, you know, streamline the characters, keep the plot simple and practical, just
wrap everything up for all characters. Make all the characters
relevant. It sounds like they're tired of this. Like they're really pulling the bottom barrels. You know what? I really hope that they just...
I think that's why they rushed season four.
Well, honestly, I think it's two things. Number one, they were interrupted to do their actual process. Nick wanted to have another blockbuster. I don't know if there's been a leadership change in Nick. I don't know any specifics of that, but I've noticed that they're trying to pump out a lot of crap lately.
Right.
And it's not working. And case in point. So, I mean, you know what? If you guys are encountering trouble from up top, I hope it alleviates. It's already done at this point, I guess. I just hope you guys were able to keep it together long enough to finish strong. Because honestly, your first series is near and dear to our souls. I'm not even joking
when I say that. One of the best things of all time, for sure. Storytelling-wise.
So, we're pulling for you. We're critical, but we're pulling for you. To the nameless creators whose names I've forgotten.
Mike DiMarnantino and Brian Canizzo. I'm pretty sure. Off the top of my head, something like that. Brian and Mike.
I've heard Mike and Brian. Yeah. I've heard that.
Yeah, we're really tight with those guys.
Yeah, you know.
Mike and Brian and Mike and Kev. We go way back. We used to actually do another podcast together. But, you know, that was a past lifetime. That was the last podcast. That's a previous podcast. So, take it easy, guys. We'll catch you later.
Later. Like, comment, subscribe.
And peace.
Janora never gave up hope. Thanks to her leadership, I see a very bright future for the Air Nation. Of course, there would be no Air Nation without Avatar Korra. She opened the portals and somehow the world began anew for us. And she was even willing to lay down her own life in order to protect ours. There's no way we can ever repay her for all she's done. But we can follow her example of service and sacrifice. So while she recuperates, the Air Nation will reclaim its nomadic roots and roam the earth. But unlike our ancestors, we will serve people of all nations, working wherever there is corruption and discord, to restore balance and peace. Avatar Korra, I vow that we will do everything in our power to follow in your footsteps.